So finally the day has come where Elon has held his long-awaited Starship presentation, and we are absolutely not disappointed. On the contrary, it was everything we hoped for and more, and only Elon and his vision for space exploration can get us so excited.
So in this episode, we will break down all the important information from the presentation and also give you our own interpretation and thoughts. There's a lot to talk about, so let's get started. So let's first start with the new Starship design, which is of course the most obvious change. We could already see the new design unfold before our eyes in the last few weeks, when we suddenly saw only two fins, or better, two wing-like structures being attached to the Starship Mk1 in Boca Chica, instead of three. At that point, of course, a lot of speculation was already floating around as to the reason of this design change. And then when the two halves were joined recently, we could see the Starship prototype for the first time in full height and also together with the upper smaller wings. Now of course the reason for these design changes are aerodynamics, but we will talk more about it later.
So then let's get into the data that Elon presented on Saturday. So even though this newly updated rendering of the Starship says that the dry mass will be about 85 tons, Elon said that it will be actually closer to 120 tons, and if they get lucky, SpaceX might be able to reduce that number down to 110 tons, maybe even 100 tons in the future, but probably not less. And the Mk1 and Mk2 prototypes are actually nearer to 200 tons of dry mass than 110 tons. So a better and more efficient steel fabrication process will actually allow to reduce the mass of the Starship compared to now by almost a factor of 2. So the Starship is now 50 meters tall, and together with Super Heavy it will now stand an incredible 118 meters tall. This is 7.4 meters more than the mighty Saturn V.
Despite the weight increase, Elon stated that SpaceX will aim for Super Heavy to have a payload capacity of 150 tons to low Earth orbit. That's quite something. Even more than 140 tons to low Earth orbit, of which the Saturn V was capable. Now the new design of Starship will allow for more stability during re-entry. Starship will fall into the atmosphere at a 60 degree angle, be slowed down by the atmosphere, and heat up the heat shield ties during that process. The 301 stainless steel has, by the way, a melting point of 1500 degrees Celsius. So therefore the heat shield ties on one side of Starship will absolutely suffice to absorb the heat during re-entry. And this solution is also lighter and cheaper than the liquid methane bleeding hull would have been. Then Starship will basically fall belly down like a skydiver. And this new design will allow for far greater stability than the three-fin Tintin design would have allowed for.
As for the 301 stainless steel, apart from the much higher melting point, he said that a major factor, of course, for choosing steel was also that it's much cheaper than carbon fiber. In fact, about 50 times cheaper. And on top, it has also the nice ability that it actually increases in strength at cryogenic temperatures as compared to carbon fiber that actually gets more brittle.
The secret of steel has always carried with it a mystery. You must learn its riddle, Connor. You must learn its discipline.
So there are a lot of pros for using the 301 stainless steel. He also added that the Super Heavy design might not be 100% final yet, because the grid fin design might still change to make them look more like a diamond shape. And the landing legs of Super Heavy will actually act as rear fins. So Elon also said that the Super Heavy booster will have an insane 37 Raptor engines, but it might happen that in the beginning it will have less Raptor engines because they might not be able to produce so many for the first Super Heavy boosters. But the end goal is to have 37 Raptor engines on the Super Heavy booster, which, wow, is quite awesome. And out of those Raptor engines, be 24 or 37, About 7 of them will be gimbaled, the others will be fixed, but that will be enough to actually steer the Super Heavy, which is also quite interesting.
Then he went on to show some cool renderings on the multiple use cases of Starship. We of course already talked often about Starship landing on the moon on this channel, because we firmly believe that Starship will be the first vehicle to land astronauts on the moon again. But then we see this rendering here, where Elon talked about establishing a permanent lunar science outpost. And Starship will play a crucial role at establishing this outpost, because with orbital refueling, Starship will offer a 100-ton payload capacity to the moon. So establishing bases there would work pretty well. Then he showed another rendering of Starship in the orbit of Saturn, which really is a fascinating possibility which Starship could offer, namely exploring the outer solar system with humans on board, which is just mind-boggling. It would certainly be nice to see Starship land on Enceladus and bring a submarine along that would melt through the ice to explore the subsurface oceans on this fascinating moon and maybe even discover life there.
And of course, we shouldn't forget that Mars remains SpaceX's main focus. So therefore, Elon showed us this updated rendering of a future Mars base with the updated Starship rendering. And then Elon went a bit philosophical on us, but we really liked it. He said basically that it should be our duty to spread consciousness to other planets and later on hopefully to other star systems as well. Because for all we know, we might be the only ones in a very large radius or in our part of the Milky Way. Now, we are a bit more optimistic than Elon. We think actually it's very likely that there are a few intelligent civilizations in the Milky Way. And if not in the Milky Way, then certainly in other galaxies. But still, consciousness is a very precious thing, and we should do everything we can to preserve it and spread it to the stars. And we can even see in our own solar system how incredibly lucky we actually are to be alive. Because let's look at Venus. It once had oceans and probably maybe even harbored some simple life forms, but then things went terribly wrong there. And on Mars also. Mars probably had conditions quite friendly to life a few billion years ago, and then things also went wrong. So only Earth remained in the solar system where life could actually evolve. And if we choose to stay on Earth, we will go extinct with a probability of 100%. Because it will take only a few hundred more million years until the temperature on Earth will rise so much due to the expanding sun that all life on Earth will be wiped out. And had it only taken 10% longer for life to evolve on Earth, we all wouldn't be here and this solar system would harbor no intelligent life. So we should consider ourselves really lucky that we even exist, and therefore we should start really getting along with each other. That would be really good. Now, as for the Mars colony itself, he didn't talk any specific details. We only have this rendering as of now, but he did actually mention something which we find quite interesting. He namely mentioned briefly underground Mars bases as a means to overcome the radiation problem. And we have to agree 100%. We on this channel are extremely strong proponents of underground Mars bases, because we think it will be very important to overcome the solar and the cosmic radiation problem, which is a real problem on Mars and which would be totally overcome and eliminated by moving our bases underground.
Now, Elon did reply to quite a few questions, and we will go through the answers in chronological order. So there was a question about the future timeline, and Elon stated that SpaceX aims to do the first 20-kilometer hops in about 1 to 2 months with the Mk1 Starship prototype. Then they will already start to build another Starship, the Mk3, which should be finished within 3 months, and a Mk4 within 5 months. And Elon said they want to make it to orbit with Mk4 or Mk5, which might be realistic, in 6 months. And that SpaceX will start to build the Super Heavy boosters as soon as possible at both Boca Chica and Cape Canaveral. However, considering the insane speed with which the Mk1 now has been finished, we think that this timeline might actually not be so inaccurate. Yes, maybe we still should add a few months Elon time adjustment, but we might see Starships reach orbit in 2020. Then Elon also said that crewed missions will start from both Boca Chica and Kennedy Space Center.
Now, replying to another question, Elon said that even for the 20-kilometer high flight test of the Mk1, the Mk1 prototype will actually perform the belly down skydiving maneuver, which will be awesome to watch. Then he also briefly talked about single stage to orbit and said that it works really nicely on the moon and on Mars, which is of course logical because the gravity there is quite a lot lower than here. But as for Earth, a single stage to orbit is almost impossible. We will need the Super Heavy to bring Starship to orbit. Even more so now, because now the Starship mass has increased from 85 tons to at least 100 tons, maybe a bit more. So Super Heavy will be needed to bring Starship to orbit effectively. Then someone asked about how SpaceX will handle possible contamination from Earth, and we have to agree with Elon on that one, because Elon said, funnily, that the biggest contaminant are humans. And yeah, when we build cities on Mars and colonies where we are going to live, we will contaminate Mars with our presence. So Mars will be contaminated sooner or later, whether we want to or not. And he also added that if there is life on Mars, that it will not be on the surface, but probably very deep below the ground, which makes a lot of sense. Now, someone else asked about the future of Boca Chica spaceport, and Elon said something very interesting. First of all, that of course it's going to be much bigger than nowadays. Second of all, that they will try to buy out the people from Boca Chica, as we know already. And third, that they will produce the propellant, the liquefied methane, on site at Boca Chica, where they will suck out O2 and CO2 from the atmosphere and, using solar power, create the liquefied methane propellant 100% by renewable energies directly in Boca Chica. Another one asked, how high is the chance that the FAA will actually approve the 20 kilometer high hopping tests quite soon? And Elon was actually quite positive about the FAA working together with the FAA in general. And we here on this channel sometimes are a bit too skeptical maybe of the FAA approval process, but Elon said actually that he sees the chances for getting an FAA approval for the 20 kilometer high tests actually quite soon. So let's see if that is actually true.
In another question, he confirmed that the pressurized volume of Starship will be around 1,000 cubic meters, and that 100 people on board of Starship would work in 0G, because one person would have 10 cubic meters on average. And in 0G, it would feel roomier, because you can stand on any surface. However, here we have to say that we are not really fans of the 0G travel to Mars solution. 0G is quite dangerous for the human body on a 6-month trip, and would have some quite bad effects, especially for the immune system and the cardiovascular system, let alone the bone and muscle loss. So we would prefer to have a few less people on board and tether two starships together on the voyage to Mars in order to create artificial 1G gravity. This would be much better for the future Mars settlers. Let's hope that this channel grows big enough and we can convince Elon that 0G is a really bad idea. Or at least, let Starship rotate on its own. A 9-meter diameter might actually be enough, with a lot of training and getting used to use the Starship hull itself as the floor. It might actually be possible to acclimatize even to such small rotation radii, as some research suggests. In any case, we think 0G is not good.
Now, replying to another question, Elon said that SpaceX is actually targeting on building one Raptor engine per day sometime in 2020. He said Q1 2020, but let's be a bit realistic here. One Raptor engine per day is quite insane, because now they still need 8 to 10 days for one Raptor engine. But of course, ramping up Raptor engine production will be absolutely crucial to be able to launch quite a few Super Heavy boosters and build all those Super Heavy boosters and Starships in the first place. And if the Super Heavy booster really wants to have 37 Raptor engines, then Raptor engine production really needs to get to one Raptor engine per day sometime in 2020. Another thing he pointed out was that rapid reusability will be absolute key for establishing a permanent outpost on Mars, because getting high amounts of payloads to low Earth orbit will be absolutely essential. So he said that Starship and Super Heavy will actually be able to fly multiple times per day to orbit. He took the number that 3 times per day is quite likely, so about 1,000 launches of Starship and Super Heavy per year. So with 150 ton payload capacity times 1,000, this would actually mean that we could bring up 150,000 metric tons annually into orbit, and nowadays all the worldwide capacity of all rockets together would be around 200 to 300 tons annually to orbit. So this would be at least a factor of 500 increase from all the rockets in the world today. This is absolutely mind-boggling.
Then Elon also briefly talked about the life support system, which SpaceX plans to be a regenerative life support system. And Elon said that this would pose no problem in order to prove the reliability of Starship. The first flights to Mars would of course be unmanned, and then crew would be increased and gradually expanded. Let's see how long it will take to get Starship human rated and have all the life support systems working reliably. We think it might be 2023, just in time for Yuzaku's Dear Moon mission.
And we saved up our favorite questions until the end, of course, so someone asked if we one day actually might be able to see a Tesla Mars rover, to which Elon replied, of course, as if it was the most normal thing. So yes, synergies between SpaceX and other companies of Elon will happen. So that's absolutely no surprise, and we're of course already curious on how these Tesla Mars rovers will look. We should really forward the idea to Elon that visual futurist Sid Mead should design those future Tesla Mars rovers. Now that would be really cool, as Sid Mead always has the best sci-fi looking futuristic designs. And the same guy then asked if Elon actually wants to take boring machines, or could imagine taking boring machines, to the moon or Mars in the future, to which Elon of course also replied, yes, it's an excellent idea, because boring machines could be used on the moon or Mars to dig nice underground tunnels, for example, for rotating habitats.
What we like especially was that Elon specifically mentioned underground bases as being good because they would shelter from solar and cosmic radiation. And this is what we are saying on this channel from the beginning. Mars bases will have to be underground, in the large lava tubes and underground caves already found on Mars. The radiation problem will be completely resolved there. The same is, by the way, also true for the moon, because we also have large lava tubes and caves on the moon. So there were a lot of infos, and we are super hyped now and can't wait to see the development in 2020. The only things we missed were solving the zero-g problem on trips to and from Mars, and also shielding against cosmic rays on said trips.
So these two things will pose some serious health risks, and we should really get bigger and promote the idea that actually cosmic radiation and zero G will be quite bad for the health, and that we need to do some Starship updates in order to mitigate those two severe health risks. So let's grow to 1 million subscribers and make Elon aware of the zero G and cosmic radiation problem. What do you say? Because both problems can actually be solved. The zero G problem by tethering together two starships and letting them rotate around their own center of gravity. And the cosmic ray problem can be solved by, for example, using hydrogenated boron nitride nanotube shielding. And we probably should raise awareness that these are two big issues that should be resolved if we want our settlers to arrive on Mars healthy in the late 2020s and have a nice, long and productive life in front of them.
So which part of the presentation did you like the most? And what do you think about the new design with the two fins instead of three? Just let us know in the comment section.
So please don't be angry with us, but for the next 5 weeks there will be only one video per week, because we're doing a large America road trip that we already booked like half a year ago, when this channel had like, what, 40 subscribers basically, and we never thought this channel would grow so large in such a short time. Yeah, thanks for that, but yeah, we now cannot step back from the journey, so we already prepared for you one video per week. It will be like not only space related topics, but more general technology related topics, which you certainly find also very interesting. But we will be very active on Twitter and Reddit, where you can follow us also.
But there is also a very good piece of news. Maybe you still remember Dr. Joseph Parker from our previous Mars episode. where we introduce his amazing Mars rotating habitat idea.
Awesome idea!
Absolutely. So we will be able to do an interview with him in Texas now.
In Dallas, Texas. Dallas.
Yes. And afterwards, we will of course upload the interview to our channel. So stay tuned.
So as soon as we return from America, we will of course continue our twice per week upload schedule with space news. Don't worry. So then see you in our next surprise episode with a surprise topic next week.
Yes.
See you.